Right there.
No, not web
address.
Address. University.
Yeah, since it's a university address, you don't have to supply the details. Just say H block minus second floor, that's enough. Okay, then I'll let people know.
Okay?
İsteyenler stadı orada kalabilir derslerden sonra. Açık olacak.
İyi günler. So I will continue with my lecture today. So how was the movie? Did you saw all of it? So okay, let me start with reviewing what I did yesterday, if you don't mind, and then continue with new subject. And I decided not to give any homework today. Continue with what you have been doing yesterday night. I'm sure like Alku gave also a homework. He did. And spend time also on that one. And I will give a statement on tomorrow about the lectures today. Okay. So do you have any questions?
So can I just one more thing? If you have any trouble ordering food or anything, I'll be here tonight. My office number is 913, 5th floor. So just let me know if you have any problems.
Let me start with asking any questions you might have about the previous lecture, about the previous lectures. No questions?
Maybe we can repeat one more time renormalization.
Renormalization?
Yes.
If you go back to renormalization, actually, I'll talk about coupling running, right? And I'm also planning to talk about more specifically about renormalizable and non-renormalizable theories in my last lecture, and like how which more specifically about in terms of interactions and stuff.
Okay. Yeah, we have a question.
Okay.
We were discussing that Nodus current. We have the Nodus current.
Okay.
And there was a little J and the capital J.
Yes.
What were those? The little J was current density.
Yes.
And
the lowercase J was defined as the conserved current because the divergence of that was zero.
Uh-huh.
So the capital J I introduced as the deformation of the Lagrangian density after the transformation. Okay, so remember as I said, like you were looking at like, you know, derivation, the transformation, the field goes to say alpha delta. And said, okay, and one thing you can say, okay, this is a symmetry, this transformation is a symmetry if the Lagrangian density is invariant. Because equations of motions are invariant. But this is too strict. You can also allow the divergence term. Because this is going to vanish, like, you know, at the boundary. Vanishes at the boundary, the action is going to be invariant, and the equations of motions are going to be invariant. So this is like the term you allow to add to Lagrangian, and still consider the transformation as symmetry of the theory. And in today's example, for example, in the complex Van Gordon, you didn't need to include that. That wasn't in check. And just plug in the test. And then the little j is done, which was constructed. Which led to a charge if integrated zero-confined over the whole space-time. And I asked you not as a homework, but for your own pleasure, to check back in this zero. Any other questions?
So, delta phi, can it, how does it depend on x?
Okay.
It just depends on the phi. Not alpha, delta phi. For example, can it depend on the derivative of the phi?
You mean higher order like you know these?
Yeah.
Higher order like you know I mean?
Yeah, yeah, higher order.
Let's say beta. Like this?
Yeah, kind of. Delta phi is just a new field, right? It's just a new field.
Delta phi is a change.
The change, so but it's a field on its own state, yeah.
No, I mean, why is it, it's not a new field. It will be in terms of the other field, in terms of what now we're using.
It's a function of the other fields.
Yes.
And
derivative should be also possible. Yeah. But it's going to be more complicated. As I spoke yesterday, I mean, you have this, the conformal theories. And there, like, you know, you have, like, you know, you are not only allowing, like, time-independent changes, but you can also change it in both. But then you have more constraints on the list of the correlation functions. Any other questions? Otherwise, I'm going to go over what I've done in my third and fourth lectures. So, okay, what did we do? The first thing I introduced was something most of you have already seen many times in quantum mechanics courses, which was a simple harmonic oscillator. Right? So, the simple harmonic oscillator has the Hamiltonian square. Then we introduce A and A dagger in terms of X and P, and then show, or I didn't show it to you, I hope you did, that this can be written as 1/2. Okay? So that means we saw, like, you know, the spectrum of this Hamiltonian in terms of, like, using this A and a dagger by arguing. That must be a state which I denoted as, like, you know, zero, like this zero cap, which needs to be isolated by the operator A, because if we have a state, an eigenzero of the Hamiltonian, means, like, you know, an eigenstate, the eigenvalue epsilon, then we argue A acting on A epsilon is another eigenstate, but the energy is lowered by one unit. Since the Hamiltonian is positive definite, I cannot do this procedure, like, you know, indefinitely. Otherwise, I mean, if I start with a positive epsilon, I cannot apply A a number of times and eventually go to the negative energy eigenvalues. That's, the Hamiltonian is clearly positive, so that's not possible. So the vacuum state or the ground state should exist. Okay, so then you can also show a dagger is raising the states and creating new states. So I said there will be states, and you should probably also work out the normalization for those states. Acting a dagger n times to the ground state, and of course, I mean, the way to find the normalization is to demand these two states, and the inner product between two states n and m should be a Kronecker double, they should be orthonormal to each other. And by imposing this condition, you should be able to figure out, like, you know, what the coefficient is in front of this to make it. I hope everybody knows how to get normalization. We can talk about it later. Okay, that's one. And then, okay, let me tell you one last thing. So if you want to construct the state in terms of in the position space, you can always look at this. Yes. Start with this. Imagine you want to look at the ground state in the in the position basis, so you know that zero. And since I can write down A in terms of the x and t operators, and if I write this in the position basis, I'm going to get like first order differential equation. And I can solve this differential equation and get the Gaussian. And by applying a dagger on this Gaussian, you may construct the whole power in the position basis as well. Like you construct this abstract gas. That's simple. But as I said, I mean, if you haven't done this computation in full detail with the normalization and with the wave functions and stuff, you should be at least once. So the next thing was we wanted to quantize the Klein-Gordon field. And the equations of motion for the Klein-Gordon field was zero. So then, in the first lecture, I tried to convince you there are certain like conditions that field theory should satisfy, and using those constraints, we argued that phi can be written as a Fourier decomposition. And let me remind you my notation here again. So if I had a bar on x or t, they correspond to spatial t vectors, not the four vectors. And usually this is like a scalar product between the three components, spatial components of those vectors, and I was denoting like px. I try to always consistently note by px, the four vectors product. And it goes to be more explicit here. So then if you just like, you know, take this field and substitute in the Klein-Gordon equation, what you get is and then we said, huh, look at this equation, that looks like very much like this one, I mean the harmonic oscillator. But now we don't have one frequency, we have like, you know, a continuous spectrum of frequencies which we know to apply omega p. And we said like, you know, for each mode, we can apply like, you know, we can write down the creation and annihilation operators AP and AP dagger. I mean, this procedure is called in many books and by some people like the second quantization, although you are not quantizing anything for the second time. It means now, here, like, you know, it was a wave function in Klein-Gordon, but I mean, it's like a wave function. But in the field theory, this wave function becomes an operator because now the nodes are going to be elevated to operators which satisfy certain, like, you know, computation relationships. Okay. And this was one of the homeworks. Right, I mean, I asked me the homework. Take this computation relationship, right? That most of you remind you, this is like a Klein-Gordon case. And that this is a simple harmonic oscillator. So okay, let me repeat this. Simple harmonic oscillator is just there as a tool. Right? I mean, it's just a method, like it's a nice mechanism like we did all of to solve harmonic oscillator, and we are applying that mechanism now to solve the Klein-Gordon. Okay, so now in the simple harmonic oscillator case, we have a single frequency W, omega, sorry, and omega satisfying one. Okay, now so since we have a continuous spectrum of like you know A and A daggers, now this normalization is done with the delta zero. And once we have like you know this Fourier mode, we can write down the field in the Schrödinger picture as about the homework, I ask you to use this relationship, this computation relationship, to get the computation relationship for the field with this conjugate momentum. Okay? So, this is the question. So, you have the Fourier decomposition for the fields, you can plug them in. Everything is here, numbers except this A and A dagger. So, this is going to be the computation relationship between this one. This term, then let's say AP will commute to AP or AP prime. When you write them, you should make sure you write one of the integrals with like AP prime. So this will this AP prime is going to commute to AP and blah blah blah, blah, and then you will have this like you know, commutators which even on something not zero. Then you will have that Dirac which is going to equate or like you know after a sign like you know, P and P prime. That's going to eat up one of the integrals. Then eventually you will end with an integral, and that's going to give you the delta Dirac. So x prime. Okay.
Sorry.
Yes.
Oh. Maybe it's easy, but I can see. How can we take two terms into parentheses?
On this one?
Yes.
Just that P goes to minus P.
Okay. The subscript is minus P?
Yes, the minus P.
Okay.
Yes.
I don't understand the P and the operators. Like there are infinitely many operators for each momentum state.
Yes.
But so for each particular for each momentum state, each operator
So you mean like, you know, what does it create?
A particle at this moment?
Yes.
So you creation is the exact creation of a particle, like a real particle. Not like in the classical harmonic oscillation, which you like, which would exact the...
Yeah, but in the field theory, exactly. Particles are the excitations of the fields. Excitations. But I think, like, you know, I mean, okay, this is going to create a momentum state. This way. So remember yesterday, we said, like, we define a state which is, like, you know, denoted by V. We denote this, like, you know, of proportionality, AP, vector. And then we also measured its momentum and stuff, like it was like the sum of our all modes, right? But the other more important thing is like when you look at like, you know, IAQ on that, so that creates an excitation at a point X. So these are more like the momentum space. That creates a, like, you know, a particular excitation at X. And then if you look at like, you know, in the momentum space, like you do, and remember like this gives you EX in quantum mechanics, a plane wave. Similarly, this also gives you something which propagates like, you know, the plane wave. Because I mean, as I said, I mean, this is labeled by the P, this excites the momentum. And there are also like commutation relationships between like H and AEP, AEP dagger, we wrote. And again, like in the harmonic oscillator case, like, you know, we constructed our vacuum by imposing AP to zero. Because I mean, the Hamiltonian is stable and it has a, like, you know, lowest energy set state and cannot go to minus infinity. That's why it has to this like, procedure by like, you know, going down. The energy by applying of AP should stop at some point, and that's the state we call like vacuum. And then we constructed the Hamiltonian, and that was one of your problems. You construct H, and okay, I wrote down like the final expression like yesterday, and to give you a tip about homework. Remember before you wrote AH like this. Okay, this is for Planck Bolden. This was one of the examples actually. The example that I wrote, like, you know, the going from the Lagrangian to the Hamiltonian, and once you have the Hamiltonian, you know the Fourier expansions or expansions, mode expansions of pi and phi. Here, you just plug these representations into that, and play with the commutators and like, you know, collect terms together, and eventually this is going to lead you to this expression.
Can I ask?
Sure.
Where did this 1 over 2 from in front of pi x squared come from? I mean, it's the transformation. Legendre transformation,
yes.
I suppose, but 1 over 2.
What was the Lagrangian? I mean, the Lagrangian was always like, it had that one.
It's that part, the rest of it, but that one is pi times phi dot I.
No, but okay, this was the Lagrangian, right?
Okay.
Plus, minus one half.
How
This was the consciousness I started with. And then the canonical momentum.
Okay.
And then we argued this C number is actually infinite. But we are not going to like measure that infinite because it's like the zero point energy of infinitely many harmonic oscillators. And we are going to ignore and hopefully we are not lucky. In the simple harmonic oscillator case, remember like the energy of the ground state was 1/2 h bar omega, but here we are going to assume this is zero. We are just getting rid of the infinity because we only measure the differences. Also, I defined, which was part of the homework, we defined this momentum operator. Okay. And this momentum operator is the more physical one. The conjugate momentum was just like a formal, variable. I mean, it can be a momentum, for example, in the classical mechanics. Imagine a particle moving in a potential. So this is your Lagrangian. And if you look at the momentum, conjugate momentum corresponding to x prime, x, this is m x dot, which is the honest to God momentum in the x direction. But imagine you couple this, it's a charged particle, and you couple it to a magnetic field. And you couple it to a magnetic field, then it's going to be more complicated, and the conjugate momentum is going to also pick up terms from the magnetic field. So it's not going to be the physical linear momentum you learned at the freshman, but it's going to be more complicated. But I can write this two integrals separately. I can write this one integral and this other, and then play it with this integral. Because I want to factor out this, the plane wave into the IPX outside. That's the whole purpose. Because I mean, omega p is p squared. Of square root of this. So that's invariant under taking p to minus p. And I'm integrating over all momentum. Doesn't matter if I just integrate minus p of p. Okay. So I'm just integrating over all directions, so it doesn't matter whether I'm doing minus. So this is invariant under this situation. This is invariant. That's why I'm allowed to do this. And when I do this, this group becomes like the same factor, and I just factor it out, and then I will have an operator.
Okay, we have a field and we are integrating over the whole momentum, but shouldn't we have some boundaries? Doesn't field have any constrictions? It can create any particle at any momentum?
Now, if you want to create a particle at a certain point, that's the thing. If you it's a definite point, then it's getting boundaries from all modes. But these are not particles. I mean, you are not creating infinite energy particles.
What?
You are not creating infinite energy particles.
Okay, but it seems that we can know
if we are. But if you create a state like that, I see what you're saying. Then we define this operator P, which I again wrote down like the final expression. But if you go back to the previous lecture, this was defined as languages. Again, the same thing. So in the homework, you needed to write this in terms of the creation and creation operators. You just take this definition and plug off those fields, manipulate, and you should be able to get the final expression I wrote like yesterday. Okay?
One more thing.
Yes.
Maybe I always asking simple questions, but I didn't understand really how we ignore this infinite. Maybe because of terminology, what do you mean by zero-point energy?
The zero-point energy, I mean, when you say, this is like the term that people use in the simple harmonic oscillator. So you always have like this energy, I mean, at the ground state or the simple harmonic oscillator, you have this like, you know, H bar. Lambda 1/2, I mean half H bar omega energy. So this is always there. The energy is never like, you know, zero.
Yeah.
So and then you have like, you know, this ground state energies summing up here. Yes. You have infinite many modes, which is sum of all of them.
Okay. Okay.
Can you imagine that? Yes.
This may be basic, but is there a source of fields?
Source?
Yes.
Not in the, we will use source for different things.
Okay.
What do you mean source?
What is Klein-Gordon field? Why does it quantize, or how did we get the equation of motion of it?
Yeah, it's from Lagrangian.
Why do we have this Lagrangian? What is the physical meaning of Klein-Gordon field?
One of the simplest explanations is like, you know, if you want to, I think this comes like from one of the early attempts of making quantum mechanics relativistic. Because in the classical mind, it's going from like, you know, classical mechanics to the quantum mechanics, you have this like, you know, simple and partially wrong like identification. They say, take pi and take it to this, and take E to the derivative with respect to time. Okay, they have this simple identification, more or less identification. So if you are writing down the Einstein's like an equation for the energy, and substitute like an E and for P, then that's what, and then you get Klein-Gordon. Right? I mean, C squared, right? When C is equal to 1. So if you plug this here, the time derivative, and like the derivative, it will like the spatial derivative here. Then you get the Klein-Gordon equation.
So what does phi and pi represent?
Phi represents the field.
Pi?
Like, okay, I mean, in this picture, it's like the wave function.
Okay.
It's the Frobel distribution.
So pi?
Pi is the conjugate momentum, like, you know, to the field.
Okay.
But I think, I mean, the way the Klein-Gordon first appeared is like this at hand. Because, I mean, in the usual, how you do write down the Hamiltonian, right, in the special like, you know, position, how do you get Schrodinger equation? You have like the P over N. So this is the, you know, this is the Hamiltonian plus V. So if you write this in the position basis, P is replaced by the derivative. And then X, you just leave X as X, it's an operator. And then you get the Schrodinger equation. But They said, okay, now we don't have the Newtonian kinetic energy, or like Hamiltonian, we have like, you know, this other energies relationship. And that's like, you know, take the borrow this idea, substitute E with the time derivative and P with the derivatives, with spatial derivatives. Let's apply this to the Einstein's equation. And then this, the first thing you get is the Klein-Gödel. Yes.
When we operate the distraction annihilation operator on vacuum, we get zero, right? So does that mean that there is no particles in the vacuum state?
Yes, it's the zero particle state. You remember in the Fox space, when I wrote the Fox space, this was a tensor product, but I also included deliberately like in a Cooper space of zero particles and one particle. So that's zero particles.
But for example, the Casimir effect or things like that, vacuum to vacuum transitions. So
yeah, that's right. I mean, it is a non-trivial Hilbert space. If you have like many vacuum of your theory as possible, then you know you can have those transitions, and they are called instantons. You can go from one configuration to another one, non-perturbative, because it involves like a tunnel leak, essentially. And then that's possible. I mean, the theory may have like, you know, different vacuum, and actually the number of vacuum should not be discrete. The theory whose vacuum is like, you know, a manifold. It's just a continuous space. So you may actually have it like, you know, a continuous complex variable to label the possible vacuum of the theory. So it can be non-trivial, that space. But it can have like, you know, for example, I mean, you have like, you know, things like, I mean, we'll talk about it later. I mean, the problem. And what was I going to talk about? Okay. Another question? Yes?
What exactly are the oscillations? What exactly are the frequencies?
The frequencies?
Yeah.
I mean, there. Here, I mean, they are the energies. You can think of them as the energy, because I mean, I'm always like assuming h bar is equal to zero, so you can just actually multiply with this h bar. And
what's the energy of?
Of that specific moment, that fluctuation. Yeah. I mean, the vacuum, it's not like it's dynamic. It's just here, but it's one of the fluctuations. I mean, that's also in the perturbation theory. Remember, like, we're talking about the possible effect of mutual particles. And, like, you know, in the second perturbation, the perturbation where you are just getting contributions from all this, like, power of the states. And they correspond, for example, to possible transitions momentarily from, like, you know, one state to the other and coming back. So you need to, like, think about all these, like, possible quantum fluctuations. You need to take anything take on. And this is actually, like, you know, summing over all these possible quantum fluctuations.
I didn't follow any of that.
Okay. Okay. For example, if you're like in a solving, you imagine you're in the second order perturbation theory for simple harmonic oscillator. So you have like a simple harmonic oscillator, and you have some small perturbation, and you want to compute like, you know, the energy shift of this perturbation to the simple harmonic oscillator. And what you do is you can compute the first order energy, right, which is if we have like perturbation, right, Hamiltonian, the first order is going to be, any state is going to be the matrix element M, and you just squeeze it. But remember that yesterday I wrote an expression which was sum over all possible states. So if you are looking at like, you know, second order perturbation theory, you need to sum over all states, which go all the way to infinity. If you want to like understand this, so then you will be summing over things like, you know, perturbation of the state over Dn. So you are summing over all the possible. And here, actually, what do this compute? They kind of compute transitions, right? I mean, you have an initial state, and you go like into the final state. and use some of all these possible transitions from like a given state to another state. And the shift, the energy level is getting contributions from all these quantum fluctuations. Look, quantum mechanics is not like classical mechanics. We have tunneling. We have mutual processes. It's much more complicated than classical mechanics. And of course, the contributions are suppressed by the energy difference. So this will get more contributions from neighboring energy states rather than infinity. Because if you are looking at the energy, let's say, level at million, and you will have million minus one, if you're looking at shifting the first, let's say, level, this is a huge number in the denominator that's going to be suppressed. But you still get a non-zero contribution. So here then you can also then you have different modes. And different modes have different energies. And you can correspond your frequency to those energy states by dividing by each one. Any other questions? Okay. So I hope it's a little bit more clear now. And I also want to try to give some tips about homework. Okay. So actually, we are not done with the Klein Gordon, so let me continue with that. States were evolving. So then I also talk about in the Heisenberg picture where the operators were evolving, the states were stable. And there, this is probably the last part of your homework to draw the equations of motion in the Heisenberg picture for the field and the conjugate momenta. Remember, the evolution of operator was given this. And then applying this, we also get the field in terms of four vectors. In terms of I can absorb here, and in the previous definition or in the previous representation, these were only three dimensional scalar products. Now, after including that, the zero component, it should be EP, the energy of the mode. Then we have four vector scalar products, and so this is going to be the operator evolving in time, and this is like, you know, in the Heisenberg picture.
I'm telling you, sorry, what did you write under the square root?
2EP, or I'm just using interchangeably, like, you know, omega p.
Okay.
So this time it's not, it's a four vector product, right?
Here, this is, yes. This is four vector. Okay, this is like, you know, another, like, you know, I mean, okay, this is my EX, so here mu comes from 3, and also people write down I, and they just, and it only goes over spatial. But this is notation most people use, and you might find other notations, but usually they tell what they're using. So once I have this field, okay, so I can look at this curvature. I can look at this two-point function. It's called two-point function because it depends on two space-time points. Okay. So this is essentially like the probability for me to create a particle out of the vacuum at position x. So this will evolve, and then I measure it again at the point x, and then it's annihilated and goes to vacuum. Okay, this is this transition probability. And this is called, I'm going to call this by dx minus y. And what you can do is you can actually, like, you know, plug stuff in and get this integral. Again, here this is a four vector scalar product, not three. And does everybody see why we are getting such a simple, like, an expression from this? The reason is, I will have like a bunch of, like, you know, I will have three factors, right? I mean, just like multiplying this one with the same operator but at a different point. So I will have, like, you know, four terms, including like this AP and AP dagger. But, you know, AP acting on the ground, on the cap, gives you zero, as well as AP dagger, the Hermitian conjugate of this expression, the AP dagger acting on the bra is also giving zero. So there are a bunch of, like, you know, terms here which are going to, like, you know, hit the vacuum and give you zero. Of course, I mean, before I sandwich this, like, an operator between these two vacuum, it's not as simple, but once you do this, then you will get, like, a bunch of zeros, or most of them will be zero. And, you know, this is Lorentz invariant.
Can you please repeat the meaning of dx minus y, yeah, the creation of a particle at point y?
Oh, here, this one?
Yes, yes, yes.
So this is the transition, like, I mean, I start with the vacuum and end up with vacuum. I'm looking back into vacuum transition. So here I create a particle at point, in that space-time point at y. It propagates, and then this is the probability, right, to go back to, I mean, that particle is annihilated at x, and then goes to vacuum. So that's this transition. And this was part of your homework, the last part, the second part of the second homework, to argue for a generic integral of this one with this, like, you know, being f of p. And I forgot to write, I mean, fp is supposed to be Lorentz invariant as well. If this function is like Lorentz invariant, this integral is Lorentz invariant, although it may not look like that because you have a three-dimensional momentum integral with, like, an EP, which depends on the three momentum. But this is your homework, I mean, to show in generic situation, I mean, this measure gives you Lorentz invariant quantities as long as it multiplies a Lorentz invariant function. Okay, so there are things like, you know, we can check. One of the things we can check is that, you know, different separations. One of the separations is, let's look at two point, I mean, let's take this problem. So this is essentially like the particle at y is created at a certain point in space, is created at some point, and then is annihilated. What's the probability of this? I mean, okay, so here x and y are space-time points. Okay? Here I mean, like, you know, there is a time difference of t, but they're at the same location. In space, they're at the same location, created and annihilated. It does it only propagate in time rather than in space. So this is like a time like interval. Well, then okay. Okay, you need to check this for yourself. Let me elaborate on this as more form. Since the difference in spatial time in space is zero, this is only going to pick up the P0. In P0, remember we said like to be EP, and you have EP here. You have another EP over here. And I just write down like, you know, this DP cube explicitly. And then integrate the angular part. Because it's like symmetric. And then you can just write this as you can call e m squared and e becomes.
Sorry, what about the boundaries of the integral? Should it be from 0 to infinity? Ah, because you switch to
all the coordinates. This, okay, this is here. P. Thanks, actually. I should have written it down. This is both M, P. Okay. So then P is square root of P squared minus M squared. And if I plug this everything into this one, this will turn into. And if you plug this in Mathematica, which I did last night, that gives you something ugly. Your Bessel function, etc. So, but you can argue, since it's oscillating, like, you know, okay, so all plus it's oscillating very rapidly, if you go to the upper bound, this integral only gets contributions from the lower bound. And I don't know any other better way to say this, maybe. I think you need to convince yourself. Equaling me, I also need to convince myself. So if you look at the t equals infinity limit, when this is really rapidly oscillating, this will only get contribution from the lowest possible part. And then this integral will be oscillating. Yeah, so it's non-zero. There's a non-zero problem. But okay, this was space timeline, so it wasn't as interesting. So imagine we are like, you know, really spatial separation. And I'm looking at the same time is off. So I'm looking at, like, you know, the propagation of the particle from one point to the other point at the same time from one location to the other. So now goes back to the spatial part, and you can play with this to get this expression. Okay, let me also talk about the intermediate steps. So, okay. So what I can do here is the here I also do the angular part first. Let me also do the angular part first here. But you know, this equals a sine theta, and I will get a cosine theta. So I can use this, like, you know, I can perform this integral. So this will become 2 pi q. This is like, you know, evil. Because here, even because I mean, you have like, this gives you a sine of p, you have an odd function, you have another odd over here. This is even, so this is an even integral. And you can actually, like, you know, go and double, and instead of going from 0 to infinity, you can go from minus infinity to infinity. Poles, okay, so in the if you take this like integral of the complex plane, so we are integrating along this contour. So, like, this is supposed to be like, you know, integration from minus infinity to infinity, but this has poles like, you know, here and here. Minus m plus im. This is the p plane. Actually, it doesn't have poles, it has branch cuts, because I mean we have skirt in the denominator. I choose my cuts to go to infinity. And I can deform this contour to wrap around, like, you know, this. Right? Because I don't have any other poles or singularities. So, I mean, if I just carry out this integral in the complex plane, I can always, like, you know, take my contour and deform it without crossing any singularities. And I just take this integral around the branch cut.
You can turn out of the integral, like, minus 1 over in the last step.
This one?
Yeah,
out
of the integral.
Like, okay, all right. 2 pi squared r. There is a minus I. And then I can define here rho to be I prime, I minus pi. So then this integral And I can look at the behavior of this when the separation between those two points are was equal. I'm just looking at the correlation if the part is the points I'm looking at are infinite apart from each other. Because of the exponential separation, again, mathematics doesn't give you a nice answer for this. You can argue this goes like e to the minus mr, which is non-zero. So it looks like this d becomes non-zero for spatially, although exponentially suppressed, it's non-zero for like, you know, for space like separated events. Then the question arises, like, you know, okay, is this really the quantity I need to look for? Is this really, like, you know, the something I really want to, like, you know, consider as a measure about the causality?
Is D like permuting that?
Yes, more or less.
Sorry.
Transition amplitude.
What do we mean by space like separated events?
Space like separated events. So if the light cannot reach from one point to the other point. Oh, sorry. Okay. The distance between two space-like, you know, points, like, you know, is to go from one to the other, you need to move faster than light. So which means, like, in more technical words, it's outside of light. No, enough. That's the point. That's the whole point. Even if you look at if the equal time, like, you know, keep the distance like really, really far apart, there is still exponential subpress, but non-zero probable or non-probable amplitude. No, I mean, then the real question is whether it affects causality or not. But the first question you need to ask, I mean, is this the real measure to judge causality? To say that theory breaks or doesn't break the causality, is this really the quantity you need to, like, you know, pay attention? That, like, when you create a particle and just, like, you know, propagates, then goes to this point which is, like, you know, space like separated. So it turns out that's not an issue. Maybe we need to look at the quantity. Rather than looking at the propagation, what we need to discuss is, like, you know, whether, in terms of measurement, whether, like, the two space-like measurements, space-like, you know, perform at one point affects another the measurement of another measurement at a space-like distance. That's the question we need to ask. Whether, like, because I mean, to get the particle, maybe say to be able to say this particle is here and then somewhere else, we just need to see the particle. We need to make a measurement. And I think, okay, I mean, this might be a wrong analogy, but one way to think about this, I guess, could be useful, is tunneling again. So imagine this. So you have, like, a potential wall, right? You just send a plane wave. Okay. So that means, you know, plane wave decays, doesn't oscillate. And then you have an amplitude, like, on the other side. So if you look, I mean, imagine this is like V, and the energy of the particle is smaller than V. So if you look at the wave function, it is non-zero in this specific coordinate region. Okay. So there is also a probability there. But can I see? Can I really find the particle there? Can I ever see a particle in the, like, you know, specific coordinate region? No. I can't, because if you do the computation, like, you know, if you want to see the particle, you need to be able to locate it at this distance. So this is like the bell as a distance L. So your delta L, you know, you need to be able to make a measurement, which is, like, you know, with that precision, delta L. But I know the Heisenberg uncertainty principle. If I want to locate, like, you know, my particle within distance L, then I know I'm going to have an uncertainty momentum, which has to be greater than h over 2. So as soon as I want to locate the particle there, the uncertainty in energy is going to be so high, the particle is not going to be there anymore. Or when I measure its energy, it's not going to be any more smaller than B. So there is no way, although the amplitude is non-zero, there is no way for me to see the particle actually in the classical forbidden region. What I can do is, I can set the particle and put a detector on the other side and measure like, you know, the electrons and measure like, you know, the current and measure the cached electrons. That's what I can do.
When you say classically forbidden region, you mean inside the wall, not yes. the other side of the wall.
No.
Because when you say classically forbidden region is the other side of the wall. I'm sorry.
Yeah, both.
I'm confused about that.
Yeah, both.
Yeah, both actually.
Okay.
But you can still see on the other side.
Yes, exactly. Okay, so I can see the, like, you know, that exactly. If I put particles, okay, some of them will be, of course, I'm going to have a, like, you know, a reflection coefficient. Some of them are going to be reflected. But I'm going to also have transmission. So R plus T is going to be 1. The particle is going to be either reflected or transmitted. Never get lost in that in the thing. And this is going to be non-zero. Let me give you another example. Okay, I'm not talking about the more filter. For example, take this potential. So if you send the thing, so it will also exponential decay. So you will still have like, you know, a non-zero probability of like, you know, finding the particle there. The wave function will decay exponentially. But if you look at the deflection coefficient, this is exactly 1. So whatever particle you send will be always reflected. So this wave function or this probability does not necessarily tell you that you will be able to catch the particle there. You will never see this particle here. Whatever you shoot here will be reflected. Or in this case, I mean, here there is a non-zero probability, like, you know, for the wave function is non-zero. But if you think of it in terms of a measurement, the Heisenberg uncertainty principle, you will never be able to see the particle within the potential.
But the particle
travels through that region, right? That's, you don't know. What do you mean?
It instantaneously reappears.
Yeah, it can. I don't want to talk about things I cannot. And you interpret it.
What I don't get is L is infinitesimally small, so delta P.
No, it can be anything.
Yeah.
It can be the separation between moon and earth. But then the probability is going to be exponentially suppressed. Then it's zero. Of course, I mean, if you are talking about a scanning Pauli microscope and you approach the tip with the surface, then it's like nanometers.
So in atomic microscope, we can detect particles
in the... Yeah, we can. You just approach
it. Yeah.
Okay, we start talking about the experiments. This is supposed to be... Okay, that's why my point was, okay, this is the way I think, maybe it's wrong. It won't... I hope it's useful for you too. But so there is like a zero, like a transition probability, or you know, transition. But here I have the same, more or less the same story. I mean, the actual thing is like, when I make a measurement, do I really see and do I really affect the events between space that separated, like, you know, events? And the answer turned out to be no, I can't. Because then, instead of like looking, the transition, I need to look at the commutator. I need to look at this one, this quantity, and see whether, like, you know, whether this is zero or not. Because this is going to tell me whether measurements I'm making on both, so if I change them, whether it's going to be zero or not. Okay? So the better quantity to look at is the commutator. And if you do this, if you play this, okay. I continue to write here. Okay, so it turns out, I mean, this is actually what I call, this intake is what I call the X, but this, from the commutator I will get two pieces. The interesting thing is, this will be zero for spacely separated points. Because I can always boost one of them and go like, you know, hit x minus y, to minus x minus y. If I do this Lorentz transformation, and you know, like in the way we defined them were Lorentz invariant, right? Because I mean, I had like, you know, so I have this 2EV, EP of something which is Lorentz invariant. So this is Lorentz invariant. So I can actually like make the Lorentz transformation, Lorentz boost. This should remain invariant. And for space separated points, I can take x minus y to y minus x. When I do this, this term is going to be equal to this one. And this is going to give me zero.
What is the meaning of this commutator?
Okay, this is more like, you know, I mean, telling you whether, you know, measurements, okay, space at points, whether they commute or not. Whether, like, you know, whether you can make a measurement without influencing the other one.
Here, no causality question.
Yes, the causality is like, you know, then elevated for this one. Because, I mean, this is going to be non-zero for time separated because you won't be able to do this transformation. But if your points are space separated, you can Lorentz boost, and since they're Lorentz invariant, they will cancel each other. And then you can conclude, like, a measurement you make here cannot affect a measurement you do at a, like, a point, which is space separated from the initial point. Propagate faster than speed of light. Okay, I think I've already run out of my time.
Before you stop, what about this time, same space but different time? The first example that you saw, we ended up with an imaginary number at the end. It looks like waiting enough time, we end up gaining some phase when we calculate the probability.
It's also like, but I mean, you know, it's like at the end of this, just move it like it's mode one.
Okay.
And this is, yeah. But this is also like, you know, the infinite time that I'm just like,
you
know,
it's fine. You take a few, you wait infinitely, and then you calculate the probability of finding at the same place after some time. Seemingly, your field has picked up some phase. That's what I see. That is interesting.
I mean, why do you think it's picked up? Why is the field picking up a phase? This is like, you know,
but because this is e to minus I and t. No?
Yeah, but I mean, this is not like, you know, this doesn't, it's not sitting in front of the operator. An operator is not function. Okay, if I stay, for me to say like, you know, the field is picking up a phase would mean those
Yes, but to me it looks, well, yes, I see what you mean.
It's not exactly that. I mean that amplitude is oscillating. It's not zero. Okay, so I should finish it three first, right?
Yes,
we So, since we kind of argued this is like, you know, more fundamental thing to look at, let's play around with this and should raise it and continue that. I can write this as again, I just like, you know, did a played a similar game, so I just like put both of them on the same with the same sign in front of them. Okay. Well then, for x, when x zero, the zero component of the x vector is like, you know, bigger than y, I can write this as expression gives you this. Okay? It's not too hard. It's not as hard as it seems. Because if you look at this expression, okay, and you realize it has poles on the real axis. Sorry, let me write this. Zero square minus p squared. This is the denominator. Okay. Notice that like, I didn't put a bar on P. So it is equal to this. And if I want to do the P integral, P zero, zero component integral, so I'm going to like hit like some poles. And the poles are located at plus minus. I'm actually reverse engineering. I'm just telling you, if you start with this, like, you know, with this quantity I define, you end up with this. And I throw at you like this expression, and I'm reverse engineering from this to this one. So to show the equality. So in this integral, if you want to go to P zero integral, then you have to, like, you know, deal with the residues or live with the poles. If you want to do this integral in the complex plane, you realize that there's like two poles. So if you're coming from minus infinity, you have to go around this. Of course, this is one particular way to pick the contour, right? I mean, I have four distinct ways. I can go up, up, up, down, down, up, down, down. So I have four distinct ways of, like, you know, going around my poles. But let me choose this one. So if this condition is satisfied, okay, then x naught is like bigger than y naught. So okay, what's going to happen? If I'm just writing the exponential, this is IP0, x0 minus this, plus blah, blah, blah. Then this is going to be greater than 0. And if this goes to I infinity, okay? So I times minus I is going to give you a plus. So this is going to be exponential diverging piece. But if it's the minus one, okay, then it's going to be minus I times minus I is going to be minus, so minus infinity e to the minus infinity, which is going to go to zero. So I can close my contour from below. Otherwise, I have to close it like, you know, above. But when I close my contour below with this choice of the deformation of the contour on the real line, I'm going to like, you know, pick up all like, you know, this pose. So I need to do, I need to compute the residue of this integral, of the integrand. And if I compute the residue, since I have two poles, I get two contributions. So one of them is going to be coming from like an EP, and the other one is coming like from EP, minus EP. So is this clear? Is this part clear? So I have this like this quantity, which I use as the measure for the causality of like, we are going to define the program, we are going to give us an A there. It's written this way. I just like massage it a little bit by like, you know, making the exponential the same. Then proposing this integral. Then I increase like, you know, from a three-dimensional integral to a four-dimensional integral by introducing this integral over that P0. And then when I do this, I see that I look at integrand, the integrand has poles. I deform my contour. And then by looking at the exponential, I decide for this condition when x0 is proceeding y0, how should I close my contour so the contribution from this contour goes to 0. So if I just do integral from the, along this contour, the contribution goes to 0. And from the residue theorem, I know if I'm doing a contour integral on the complex plane on a, along a closed loop, then integral is equal to the sum of the residues of the poles. I compute the poles corresponding, I compute the residues corresponding to the E minus EP and EP, and I claim this is going to be equal to this integral. However, if, let's say, look at the other condition. If x0, if event at x is before the event at y. Okay? So I go back here. So now this time becomes negative. I still have p0. So now I have to like, close the contour at the top. Right, because this is negative, this is going to give a positive minus infinity, is going to be an exponential like, you know, decaying at minus infinity, sorry, at plus infinity. So I need to close my contour. This way, and I'm not closing any poles, and closing any poles. So in this case, the integral is going to be zero. It's going to be vanish. It turns out this is the, this expression is the, can be called the retarded Twins function. Because I can define this retarded Twins function saying, I mean, explicitly putting with the theta function, when this is when x is like x0 is bigger than y0, this is 1. Okay. And to see that the retarded Green's function, you can plug this into the Planck coordinate equation. And this gives a delta graph. This shows you that the retarded Green's function. And you can actually, like, you know, work this out by yourself. Then actually, like, if you plug at this expression, I mean, take this dr. This expression, right? I mean, this is transition amplitudes for the proper for the commutator is given by that integral. But we also need to be careful because when you're acting with derivative, you're acting to the theta function. The theta function is this one. Okay, it's zero. I mean, the derivative is 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, but individually you have a double zero because it just jumps. So the derivative of the theta function along the jump is going to be that, Dirac delta. So you need to apply the chain rule here carefully. That's my point. You cannot only act with this operator on this integral, but you also take care of the theta function. And before I finish today, let me define the what's called the Feynman propagator, which is going to be useful. So Feynman defined a propagator, which is similar in spirit to this one. Effectively correspond to the formula contour this way. Again, for at minus b is dp. With this a shift in epsilon that will correspond to closing contour this way. And the property of this nice property of this final propagator is following. It gives you the x minus y for this one. Okay. So it kind of introduces the notion of time ordering. Right? If x precedes y, so this is like x minus y. You're looking at the probability of a time-like separation, or like not time, sorry. You just look at them, you're like ordering them accordingly. Y is the first one, then X follows it. So if X star, if X zero is smaller than Y, then the final probability corresponds to Y and X change. So it should then, it kind of orders you the way like you should, if X happens first and then Y. And this can be actually written as using the theta functions. Remember, like we were like talking about propagation from y to x. So now it's changed. I mean, depending on which one is first, kind of reverses the propagation from one point to the other using these theta functions. And last thing is like this whole expression. This expression, the sum of these two terms, is denoted as. So you put a T here, meaning the events. I mean, you're going to, so you have like a space-time points, and you're going to order your operators in this in this transition amplitude, such that the operators corresponding to late events will be written on the left. Right? Because I mean here, if X, this term is going to be non-zero, if x0 is bigger than y0. meaning if X is like greater than Y, X event is greater than the Y event. See, the first event is Y, and you fix up the X. If it's the other way around, then this is going to be zero, because I mean this is going to be a negative number, but and Y0 minus X0 will be a positive number. And then X event is the first one. So X is on the right, Y is on the left. This time ordering, and the good thing about the Feynman propagator is like it kind of orders events for you in time. And that's why you use this like time ordering. So, okay, so this is not what I wanted to tell you and talk about today. I wanted to go with the functional methods. Hopefully this was useful. This is a review in this part. Tomorrow I will talk, I mean, also, it's also good that I didn't give you the other homework because it was about the functional methods. So let's continue with that tomorrow. Then I give you also the homework tomorrow.